I luckily discovered it quietly on my own while in circle with my best friend who was channeling for others. So as she was channeling, I started to realize that I too was receiving messages and feeling presence that I had not before.
I'd like to welcome to the show, Stephanie Banks. How are you doing, Stephanie?
Hey, good, Alex. How are you?
I'm doing very good. I'm very good. Thank you so much for coming on the show. I'm fascinated by what you do. And I always love having channels on the show because everyone's different. Everyone connects a different way. And it's always interesting to hear different perspectives on what a channel does, how they do it, and how it affects them personally and how it affects the people that they work with. So my first question, you call yourself an intuitive channel. What is the difference between an intuitive channel versus just a run them out, you know, normal channel?
Oh, who the hell knows? I don't know, right? This is where language can fail us because it's very hard to apply words to work that is difficult to describe and really needs to be experienced for the person to be able to express what that is to them. But intuitive channel just to me means I use my intuition, which we all have, to channel, to bring in connection to divine energy, which we all are. So we're all channels. I say this all the time, and we all have intuition, and I'm no different than anybody else. I wasn't born with something that no one else has in my belief. And, but I have learned how to get out of my way. And so that's a lifelong pursuit, and which allows me to connect to spirit or the invisible realms or souls that are here on the planet or on the other side, guides, things like that, to bring in guidance, support, information, insight, energy, whatever.
Yeah, because I know the journey that we're all on here on Earth is fairly easy, and you don't have to really need any guidance, really. Just walk through life easily. Right. Nothing ever happens.
No. We had a lot to celebrate this, you know, season.
No, it's just not the way it works. So any help at all in this insanity that is the physical realm is helpful. So how did you start your journey as a channel?
About 15 years ago, I met a best friend of mine, a new friend, but she ended up being my best friend, and she did this work. She was a physical therapist by training. So I'm a speech pathologist by training, and we connected on that rehab, medical rehab connection. And she had this ability to channel, to bring forward messages from spirit to for family and friends. And that's really who she was serving at the time. Mm-hmm. And so at the same time, synchronistically, that I was learning from observing her, my mother was diagnosed with dementia, and she had a dementia that affected younger people. So she was diagnosed she had started in her 50s. And I needed to find ways to continue to connect with her and communicate with her that transcended verbal communication, because with dementia, you're pathways are breaking apart in the brain. And so most people who have it at some point in time cannot verbally communicate clearly anymore or cannot understand language in the same way. So I was connecting the two ways of using the soul connection to understand my mother better and stay connected and in communication with her, and watching my best friend serve those that she served with her channeling.
So how does it work when you channel? I always love asking that question because it's like, it's different. Do you see dead people? Are you like in the sixth sense? Like, you know, you're sleeping and all of a sudden you walk in and you're like, oh, hi, Bob. Like, how is that? How does it work? I know it's different for everybody. So I'd love to hear how your process is.
For me, I really do limit it to when I am on the clock, when I am serving others. That doesn't mean that I don't receive my own support and guidance from my spirit guides and my ancestors and loved ones who are here to bring that forward, because I do. And sometimes they do come through when I'm in the shower, when I'm in the grocery line, you know, at different times, but it never feels intrusive because it's always coming from the highest loving frequency. And I think that's the trick to feeling safe as a channel, if you can learn to have your set point at a high frequency and trust that all energies that are coming through are of that level or higher, which is my deal with my guides, then it's joyful and it's fun and it's not a drag. So that's, you know, it's been very important to me. And when I teach others to channel, I spend a lot of time focusing on the responsibility that we have to maintain ourselves clear and as high vibrational as possible.
So you're not like Whoopi Goldberg and Ghost, where someone's coming in you and like still like talking out like
no,
Lakeisha, you know, why are you wearing that hair? It was such a great scene. Oh God, I love that movie.
Best scene ever. You know what's funny is that no, I do not experience that.
Okay.
And I once went for an interview as a channel. So I wanted to provide groups through this new age store in my neighborhood. And as my interview, I actually had to channel for the proprietor, the owner of the store. I mean, that was nerve-wracking. She had 25, 30 years of experience on me. And after I channeled for her, she told me, yes, I definitely want you to offer your work here. She said, I'm also really happy to see that you are a conscious channel. And I said, oh, that's awesome. What is that? Because I didn't know how that there were conscious channels and trance channels and all different types of ways. But in the conscious channeling that I do, I am fully aware and in control of my body, my sensations, what's here, who's, I'm the only one in here. And so I don't feel worried or nervous that I'm going to be overtaken or distracted from or manipulated by any other energy or entity. One, it's just not how I learn to channel. And two, I trust myself and my guides that that's not how I will work best. So I'm not at risk for that in my work. And because of the conscious channeling.
Right. So unlike someone like Edgar Casey, who was a sleeping channel, if you sense, he wasn't aware. He didn't even remember what he said. And that's why they were dictating everything he did. That was your deal. You're like, yeah. I want to be awake. I want to be able to do it. Now, is there a difference between what you do as a channel than a medium, or is they both kind of the same thing? Again, this is like, we're getting into nitpicky stuff, but I'm just curious.
No, it's important. They are different. And I do mediumship as well. Okay. So mediumship connecting to those on the other side and channeling connecting to all energy around. So I also channel trees. I channel animals. I channel Gaia. We can, you know, and like I mentioned, spirit guides as well. And then the mediumship, yes, if my clients want to hear from the soul perspective of a loved one on the other side, definitely we can do that. I can do that.
So when you first discovered your ability, I have to believe it was fairly, I mean, I'm assuming you weren't raised with this information. You weren't raised in a family of channels, and this is just like everyday situation. So when you first discovered this ability, how did you deal with it on a psychological standpoint, just like mentally? And, you know, were you quote unquote closeted for a while before you kind of started being outward about it? How did you deal with it?
Well, I luckily discovered it quietly on my own while in circle with my best friend who was channeling for others. So as she was channeling, I started to realize that I too was receiving messages, and feeling presence that I had not before. So for a while, I just sat on that. And with that, I didn't feel confident at all to offer that up or to share what was coming through. For years, I decided that she was the only one who could do this. And whatever I was getting was not of value. This is just right what that ego mind does to keep us safe. And then eventually, my curiosity won out. And I thought, well, so maybe this is something, and maybe I do want to dive in, and maybe I won't be offering it professionally, and maybe that's not the point, but perhaps it's cool and fun and interesting. And I have so many areas in my professional life that I've done just because they're cool and fun and interesting. So I started to take courses, classes, workshops, traveling to take some of Sonia Choquette's trainings because she's a psychic medium that I really admire. And I found out it is a thing. And it took me more years. I mean, I remember the moment when I decided, okay, fine, I will offer this to others. But it took me a while. I was definitely in resistance to it. There was a lot of fear around it. This is not mainstream yet. And the work and the relationships that I had were more mainstream. So it was a stretch for me to make space for this and eventually to claim it as a part of myself. But once I did, wow, freedom and elation and joy has been the gift from it.
And when you're channeling, from my understanding, is that there's generally not someone dictating or saying things to you, generally speaking. It's more pictures or images or become almost like little mini movies or something like that. In more of a metaphor of what they're trying to say. Or sometimes it just comes, something comes through if you're doing mediumship specific to the person, like, you know, I think I heard you say once something about a cowboy or something like that. And you're like, I have no idea why there's a cowboy on a clown. I have no idea. Does that mean something to you? And then they go, oh my God, my dad was a clown and he was a cowboy. things like that. So how is it for you? Do you hear voices or is it more just images and kind of video, if you will?
So the way I experience channeling is that I am hearing, but it's not hearing through the vibration of sound waves. I am hearing the message at the same time or within milliseconds of speaking it. So when I channel, it is like a stream of words and language. I do see imagery with it, but it's not that I see imagery and then try to figure out what it is or present that to my client as this is what I see and I don't know, but I know what example you're talking about. Mm-hmm. people say that when I'm channeling for them, it sounds like I'm reading. I've actually had new clients say, are you reading something to me? No, not reading anything. But the messages come through very quickly. They sound like they're conversational or at least like a monologue almost. And it is comprehensive. It touches on so many different things. Even if that person asks one particular specific question, there is a lot that comes through around it to inform and support and provide, you know, insight and understanding into whatever it is that they are struggling with or trying to get clarity on. So that's how I do it. Imagery comes through at the same time. But what's fun when I'm channeling is that a lot of times the messages are really lighthearted and joyful and humorous. And that has to do with me being that way and my guides being that way and the way I work with my guides in that way. And also that humor is healing. And we are not here to take ourselves so darn seriously all the time. So when we go to that lighter place of joy and laughter, then actually we're healing at the same time. But I will see when I'm channeling, there's a moment in time where I understand what's coming through. I haven't spoken it just yet because there's that tiny delay, but I will smile or have a little bit of a laugh because I get the whole full picture of what this beautiful thing is that's coming. And when I look back and I watch myself on video channeling, I can see that point, which I was made aware of this beautiful piece that's here for this person. It could be humorous, it could be lighter. And then the joke comes out or the angle of what gives everything levity comes out. And that's always really fun for me.
That's fascinating. It's almost like, I mean, every time I've seen a channel work, you know, because there's a lot of people who don't believe in channeling, don't believe in any of this stuff that we're talking about. And that's fine. It's whatever's true to you is up to you. But on a logical standpoint, I look at someone because I've seen your channeling videos. I actually watched a few of them on your shows, on your YouTube channel. So I was watching them and the way you're speaking, it'd be very difficult for you to do that off the top of your head. It'd be just on a logical standpoint. Is it possible? Maybe. But you would be a savant at that point. It's just like you're speaking at us. And anytime I've spoken to channels or I've seen channels do their thing, it's always that. They're just like, hold on, let me turn on. And it's in a different cadence than their normal speech pattern. It sounds like someone else is speaking to them. And it's like, there's one channel, there's a channel I know that he speaks and then he repeats himself. He speaks and I'm like, there's just no way the human mind can do that. I think even try to read a few sentences that way, it's impossible. So that's when I was watching your videos, I was like, oh, there it is. Yeah. Cause I mean, and then if you're doing it on the fly, even like, if I ask you a question and then you're answering on the fly like that, on a logical standpoint, I can't make any sense of it. So that's why I'm like, hey, believe it or not, don't believe it, but something's coming. Something's happening.
Yes, exactly. And when I've done radio shows where I've taken callers, and that is very anxiety provoking for me, just by fact of it being live and you don't know who's coming and there's no opportunity to get to know even the person's energy beforehand. But yeah, I think there's enough evidence and science out there that supports this. We have plenty of books. We have plenty of research. This is a thing. And like you said, if it's not in your belief system, awesome. That's perfectly fine. We get to have our own beliefs about it. But I think we're way past the time where people can say that's not real.
Right. I think, from the concepts of meditation, even, back in the day, that meditation was looked at as some, weird thing in the West, never in the East. In the East, it was around for thousands of years, but in the West, it was just like, that's crazy, blah, blah, blah. And now it's been scientifically proven to all the things that it does for you and so on. So there's a lot of things in the zeitgeist now that it's fascinating to watch for me, me being on Earth at this time, even in my lifetime, how much has changed from the 80s to 70s, 80s, 90s to today, where things are, everybody's doing yoga. I remember when yoga was, the people looked at you like, you're doing yoga. What is that? Are you an Indian guru? Like, what are you doing? So there's certain things that are a lot more accepted nowadays. And I think in the future, they'll become even more and more accepted and more mainstream without question, which brings me to my next question. You mentioned guides or spirit guides. Can you explain to the audience what a spirit guide is and how do you communicate with them differently than, let's say, a loved one when you're doing mediumship? Mm-hmm.
So I like to describe our spirit guides as our non-physical energetic support network. And I also like to explain, this is my belief in my studies, but I think of them as beings that are assigned to us, sometimes lifetime after lifetime after lifetime, we travel with them, who don't necessarily have to incarnate in body, but are here to support our journeys. And so we have guides for the most mundane things, like my guides get me the best parking spot at the mall consistently every time I remember to ask them, or great discounts on shoes. If you want to talk about real material, 3D stuff.
That's amazing. They're like a caseworker. They're like a caseworker that's assigned to you. They're like, all right, you got Stephanie for this lifetime. All right, where's the file? Oh, she's got to do what this time? Oh my God. Oh, she's going to be asking for paperwork. Oh, no, parking spots and shoes. All right. Do I get help with this case? I mean, this is not going to be easy. So,
so there's that, but we also have those assigned to us for our most profound and synchronistic and like beyond our imagining, the things in our life that just, we cannot explain how that happened or through reason, but the divine timing of everything just lined up, the perfect conversation with the perfect person at the perfect time. And oh my gosh, now look what happened, So they run the gamut, and our job, I believe, because I don't believe they just swoop in and do things for us. I believe that we are in a co-creative and conversational experience with them, where we ask for the support, then we position ourselves to receive the support, which means we stay awake. We pay attention. Did we get what we asked for or something similar to it? Did we say thank you? Did we, you know, are we in reciprocity with that, with their energy? Because they do want to support and please, but we, you know, I could ask for something. And if I'm really grumpy and in a, you know, cranky place, I'm going to get a response to my request. It's going to be more of a match for where I'm at energetically. And then I might say, oh, well, my guides never listened to me. They didn't give me what I wanted. Yeah, they actually gave me close to what I asked for from the place that I was in. And that's why it doesn't feel quite right now, because I'm not in that place anymore. Or I recognize that what I was asking for was not in the highest service. So your guides will do what supports you and what helps you grow, because I feel that's what we're here to do as souls.
And, you know, I've had a lot of questions people ask me in regards to the people who surround us, you know, like spirit guides or relatives, like, you know, when your mom or dad pass away, or, you know, are they with you, are your grandparents with you? Are they helping you along the way? And I've jokingly said, oh, that's Big Brother. Big Brother's around you at all times. And they're like, do they watch us take showers? I'm like, maybe, I don't know, but they're around all the time. And we're probably a fun show to watch, to tell you the truth. I mean, we are hilarious. I've always used the analogy, I come from the film industry, so I always use the analogy of a movie, is that we are here as actors playing a part, which is not new, but the difference is that we believe the part that we're playing is the real part, as opposed to, you know, I always use Anthony Hopkins and Silence of the Lambs as Hannibal Lecter. Anthony Hopkins is the soul. Hannibal Lecter is the part. The insanity is to believe that he's Hannibal Lecter and stays on set and tries to actually start killing and eating people. That would be an insane thing. But he knows after the day is over, he takes off the Hannibal Lecter suit, gets back in his car, and he's Anthony Hopkins. And that's the thing that a lot of us don't understand. We all believe that we are the character that we are playing and not the actor inside of us. Mm-hmm. And that is, I think, the insanity that we are here, that we are having a physical experience only, where we should be more of a spirit. We are spiritual beings having an experience, a physical experience, and not just a physical, because this is some, you know, the meat puppets.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. And when you add the dimension of our limitlessness, you know, right, the soul aspect of who we are, and the fact that that continues, we actually do, it's the only thing we bring with us when we leave body, is our soul, our spirit, then it adds a dimension of purpose, meaning, beauty, light, mm-hmm, to this very dense plane that is very difficult for a lot of us, especially those who are sensitive.
Now, I was wondering, when you channel, does it wear you out physically? Does it actually take a toll on you when you're channeling for an hour or a half hour or doing sessions? Does it wear on you physically?
It depends on who I'm channeling for. Usually, no. 90% of the time, I feel very energized by the channeling, to the point where I have to wait a while before I can go to sleep, because it's, you know, there's like an activation and a joy and an excitement that comes through. So, but there have been times, depending on the, you know, the, what I'm bringing, what's coming through.
It's not always rainbows and unicorns.
Right. We're going through some difficult times right now. And it's not that heavy stuff comes through, because it's only love that I'm attuning to. But even love can feel complicated and confusing, right? And even at times painful, when we misunderstand or we're enforcing something, an outdated belief or paradigm that just simply doesn't fit anymore. But for the most part, I'm not tired by it. I have done groups in the past where I will channel for 40 or 50 people. I won't do that again, because that is depleting. That's very exhausting to bounced around so much into different energies and quickly read and bring through. So I've learned what my, when I do a group, ideally it's less than 20 people. That gives me enough regenerative energy and keeps me in the clarity that I hold as a standard. Anything beyond that, I start to feel a little muddy and murky and tired. It can be tiring. What's tiring is the concentration.
Right.
That's what can be very wearing, because the intensity of focus when I am closing my eyes and looking, you know, where I look and receiving and speaking and bringing all of that forward, it's a lot of concentration. And these days, no human has any more ability to focus. Like we're used to swiping now, and our attention span is so much shorter than it's ever been. So that can be taxing.
To say the least. Do you ever, you know, just like walking around, let's say in your normal everyday life, and all of a sudden, like you know, you meet Sally. Sally comes over, and you've known Sally for a while. You're like, hey, how you doing? Sally, I got a message for you. Look, you know, Bob came in, and Bob has something to talk to you about. Your grandpa Bob. Does that happen at any point? Do you like just like a message just just comes in, and you just have like. Do you have a second? Something's coming in and I really need to tell you this.
Sometimes I will have a soul who I've channeled and they have more to say. So they will kind of like sit on my shoulder, you know, like, hey, you know, how about, you know, tell them this or that. And I'll have to say, session's over, you know, we're done. You'll have to...
Fairly frustrating very frustrating for the soul, I have to say. Very frustrating.
They'll have their time if they, you know, if there's something, there's never been anything that I feel is like life threatening or life changing or super urgent that I must tell someone in order to preserve them in some way or protect them in some way. So that's not it. But what will happen much more frequently is that I'll be out and about in my daily life and I will. Spirit will flash someone across my awareness. So sometimes it's a client, sometimes it's a friend, sometimes whomever. And if I'm connected with them, I will send a text and just say, hey, you know, how are things? Or I'm feeling you really strong right now. Everything okay? I'll just say, you know, because I don't always know exactly the nature of it, but it's Spirit signaling me to reach out in love to someone else. Every single time I do that, well, maybe once or twice it has not happened, but every other time the person has said, OMG, how did you know to reach out to me right now? You will not believe what just happened. Or I was just thinking of you, or I was just about to schedule with you, or I just felt my mom so present and was thinking about this or that. So that happens a lot. And that's fun. That's light. That's joyful. That's life affirming. It's soul affirming. I love that.
Now, you mentioned earlier that everyone has the ability to do what you do. How can people more understand on how they can connect to that part of themselves, that intuition, how to open themselves up to that kind of inner wisdom?
Self-care, self-love, and self-compassion. So what I'm learning, even with my own resistance to all the ills of the world, is that I can activate externally and fight for this cause and that cause and these rights and those rights. But if I'm not doing the inner work of alignment and presencing myself and digging out my own limitations and looking at some of that more closely, I'm going to be very ineffective at any activism work that I do. Mm-hmm. And so to be a clear channel, I must be committed to myself, my inner state all the time. That doesn't mean that I'm always buzzing and high vibrational and, you know, giggling and skipping about. My life is just as complicated as anybody else's. And I have all the same struggles that anybody else does as well. But what I do is I prioritize my self-care and my self-compassion. So when I have made a mistake about something. And I would normally, in years past, beat myself up over that for sometimes weeks or months or a very long time. That time has shortened. I recognize the different voices. One is the egoic voice that wants me to play a smaller game so that we can stay safe. And I honor her. Okay, gotcha. Thanks, ego. I know your job, but I've got this, and it's okay. We are going to enter into more visibility now. We are going to share our heart and our spirit with the world. Paying attention to that, applying compassion to me has been very helpful. What I do as a general practice is I do have a meditative practice, of course, and meditation can come in so many different forms. For me, I also have to get out in the natural world every day. I have got to be among the plants and the animals, the butterflies and the birds, the life that occurs while I'm within these little walls doing my life, because that for me is where my soul is at ease and where I come back into the interconnectivity of all life. So I'm not actually this lone person having this, you know, independent, isolated experience of the world. I'm part of a weaving of this beautiful life on the planet, and I contribute to it or I detract from it. And I do both, right? Like, I have plastic in my house, for example, and I can be wasteful with food. And so, but I also plant a garden and I grow food, and I, you know, there's all these angles. So doing what's nourishing to us and finding those places where we can draw energy and love and compassion and kindness and connection is self-care. And that is, I believe, required, at least for me, to be a clear channel, and also deep relationships. I'm not a fan of superficial conversations. I'm not a fan of being in crowds where I have to figure out how to have superficial conversations. So I make sure.
I come from LA. So, yeah. So you could imagine.
So knowing my limitations and also my desires, and making those not only okay, but making sure I have those things that bring me joy and light and love is what's important.
Now, so many of us, I ask this question often on the show, but I'd love to hear your point of view on it. So many of us are trying to find our purpose, are trying to find why we're here, what we're supposed to be doing. And so many of us aren't happy because we're at a dead-end job, or we're doing something we just don't like. We might be making money and putting food on the table, but we're just not happy doing that question. I always love asking that question to people. I'm like, are you happy? And it floors over. That's a very profound question. And because most people don't think that. They never think that word, like, are you happy? And then when you're brought that question thrown into your face, you're just like, well, no, I'm not happy. And then just starts you down a whole rabbit hole. So back to my original question, how do you think people can find their purpose, their mission in this life?
Well, what I actually advise is find the thing or things that breaks your heart and go into service towards the more beautiful world that your heart knows is possible with that thing. So in my case, I love this planet. I feel like she is my mother. I refer to her that way. And I love all the life upon it. And so what breaks my heart, there are many things that break my heart, but one is ecocide, the destruction of life, of trees, of entire species that we are losing every day. That is so crazy making for me. So I use my gifts and my skills and my heart and my love and my resources to serve into that more beautiful world that my heart knows, because I can see it. I can see a planet where humans are living in harmony with all life. I know that that is possible. We have the capacity for that. So it's not present right now, or it's certainly not globally speaking. And so that feels to me to be part of my purpose. But ultimately, what I believe is that all of our souls are here for the same purpose, which is to love, to get as close as we can to unconditional divine love, and to grow. So if we're loving and we're growing, you got it. That's your purpose. And then the way that we express that through using our personalities or using the skills that we have honed or using the gifts that we feel we've been given or the resources that we have, that's how we direct it. But in terms of our purpose, it's to love and to grow. And I find that happiness is elusive. The word itself, how people don't even know, how will I know when I'm happy? How will you know when you're happy? Right? So happiness can be very fleeting too. Like we can feel happy in one moment and then completely lost and empty in the next. So it's an ongoing thing. And I focus my attention on joy. What feels joyful to me, that feels like a big boost of a bubble, you know, the word joy does. So that's kind of what I use as a frame of reference.
Now, with that said, even when people do find out what they are meant to do in their mission here, they're afraid to take the jump. Like you were talking about your ego trying to stop you from, you know, going more public into it with you, what you do. How do you overcome that fear?
By doing it.
feel the fear and do it anyway.
You bring it with you. Your fear is your friend. Mine is now my friend. It doesn't always feel that way because we're not always in relationship with it. We are in, you know, more like an adversity, an aversion to it, trying to avoid it or being in resistance to it. But my fears have advised me of some very important things that I am grateful for. They've told me that, oh, people will, you know, there's going to be non-believers about your work and it will feel very harsh to you because you have a people-pleasing aspect to yourself and that's going to be really hard. And oh my gosh, what will you do? What will you do? That's a fear. Yeah, it is really hard. And here I am anyway, still showing up and still doing it and applying compassion, self-compassion and self-love when I need to, which is all the time. And my fears have told me about, you know, oh, for example, your marriage can't hold all of who you are was a fear. What if there's not room for all of me in my marriage? Turns out there wasn't. So now I'm not in the marriage. So these are things that they're part of the growth. This is part of my journey, you know, my path has been to look closely at that, which is supporting my expansion and self-expression, cultivate that, and then look closely at that, which is limiting my self-expression and expansion. And if I can eliminate it or minimize it, then that's kind of my work because I am here to be all of myself.
Now, with all the work that you've been doing as a channel over the years, how has that changed your outlook on life, death, and spirituality?
Well, my outlook on death is completely different. I wouldn't say that I don't have any fears around it because I still really want to stay in the body for a good long time. A lot of things.
Yeah, everybody wants to go to heaven, but just not right now.
But I know I don't feel that death, it's not a finality. It's just only for those who feel left behind, who don't know that there it's possible to still connect with and communicate with and be in reciprocity with the soul that is no longer in body. So my view on death has shifted a lot. My view on life, I'm so much braver than I ever knew I could be. The level of courage that I have shown in my life so far has expanded, just kind of exploded with my channeling work. It's harder to hide. And I don't want to hide as much as I used to, or kind of like fly under the radar kind of thing. But that's, and what was the other one? Life, death, and what
spirituality in general.
Oh yeah. So, what I've appreciated in my work is that I have had the opportunity to work with so many people with so many varying lifestyles and spirituality views and vantage points. And, there's room for all of it, really. And we all connect to spirit differently. We all feel it differently. And that's beautiful. And you never know where someone's spiritual journey is going to take them. So I always try to keep a lot of open space around that person, their soul, their spirit, because we're expanding all the time. And the acceleration of the energy on this planet is really, really intense. So we don't know yet what's possible. And I hold that picture in my heart of the, just this endless open possibility.
Do you have a message for anyone listening now that is dealing with losing a loved one or is about to lose someone in their life, to give them some sort of either comfort or understanding on what is happening?
For people that are in the process of witnessing or supporting someone through end of life, I really encourage you to say the things that you need to say. Even if the person can't respond to you anymore, or you can't have like a normal conversation, express the love and the forgiveness that you have. And even if it's not completely fully formed, it's okay to still say it and offer it. Because a lot of times in our lives, once we can speak something out, even if it hasn't fully been revealed yet, or we're not fully living into it yet, it can facilitate that experience. So if you have someone to forgive and you have the gift of time while they're still embodied to forgive them or to offer love, tenderness, kindness, do so. I mean, really, really take advantage of that. That is not only healing for you, but can be very freeing and healing for them. And then for those who are in more acute, recent grief, be really gentle with yourself. Move slowly. Listen to what your needs are. Show compassion and forgiveness for yourself. We tend to blame ourselves and question ourselves. What if I had made them go to the doctor? What if I had done this? Did I make the wrong decision for them? And that is the fearful mind, and it's understandable, and it kind of gets flared up in these very intense emotional situations. But grief takes its own turns and it takes its own time. And we don't want to rush through or skip over anything, because then it will just hang out and express itself for the rest of your life in ways that are not healthy. So be sweet and be slow and be gentle and allow for your heart to come back to the place of connection. Your loved one, no matter if they're in form or in on the other side, in soul form or physical form, you have connection to them, and that doesn't change.
Now, there's so much insanity going on in the world today. I mean, this is almost an unheard of thing that's happening between every aspect of, you know, conflicts within countries, environment, politics, financial, a pandemic, all this kind of stuff. There is a shift going on in the world. What do you think, or what does your guides or your work, do you have a message for people going through what we're going through? I still, by the way, don't believe that we've hit the bottom of this situation. I think we still got a little bit more to go before we hit bottom. So things might get worse in the near future. What do you think? What do you have? What kind of message do you have for that?
Buckle up.
Strap in. Strap in's going to be one hell of a ride.
Yeah, I'm not coming from a negative perspective in saying so, but we are in a desperate time, and it is charted to continue. I mean, you just look at data and evidence, and I do believe in science. So we have a lot of work, but we have also chosen this time to be here, right, to embody. And so how I think of things in terms of like a legacy. When I'm at the end of this lifetime, what do I want to have said about me or say about myself, about the way that I served or how I showed up to this? And some days I don't want to get out of bed too, you know, like the issues are so enormous. They're so beyond what I can feel any level of control around. I mean, I shed tears just today about the fireworks what are the fireworks? You know, like it's so loud and the wildlife is, you know, scared off and my dogs have to be medicated. And it's like, and then the people with PTSD and those who have been victims of gun violence having to hear the sounds of what a firework, you know, like this is something that is very, there's so many things that are distressing. I'm using a very small example because of course we have wars and everything else going on, but we are here now. That is the truth. And we are here for a reason. And even if you don't identify that your purpose is like, say, to make the planet a better place or to save the trees or the chimpanzees or whatever it is, you are here to bring love and compassion earthside. So keep doing that. And that means, again, coming back to the inner you, you have to start from within. I'm an activist on many different fronts, and that can be very depleting. So I have a responsibility if I'm going to show up to do the whatever I do, then I have a responsibility to bring the highest version of myself. And when I am starting to get, when the anger or the frustration or the rage is getting the best of me, then I have to find a way to release that, not on others, but in whatever ways that I do that are more healthy. So it's really rough right now. And there's no indications that we are going to enter into an easier time, even in my lifetime. I would like to say differently, but I'm also here to serve in this way. This is why I'm here. And I'm up for it. You're up for it. We're all up for it.
Strap in.
We can do it. Yeah.
Strap in. It's going to be one hell of a ride. Now I asked my guest two questions, but you've already answered one, which is what is the purpose of life. But I'd like to ask you, what is your mission in this life?
My mission is to light a path for others to return to their truth, their inner voice of wisdom, their own intuition.
Fair enough. And where can people find out more about you, your book, and the work that you're doing?
On my website, soulinsight.com.
It has been, Stephanie, it's been amazing talking to you. Thank you so much for coming on the show. It's been fun, to say the least. We've had a lot of laughs, and hopefully this conversation will help a soul on their journey as well. So I appreciate you. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Alex. Thanks so much for the opportunity.
Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey, and don't forget to subscribe.